Silent Witnesses by Nigel McCrery, read by William Gaminara. Introduction. Murder has a magic all of its own. William Roughhead, Scottish criminologist, 1870 to 1952. The morning of the 21st of November, 1983, dawned cold. The wind was bitter, the sky dark and bleak. On her mother's advice, 15-year-old Linda Mann dressed warmly before leaving for school. She wore denim jeans over a pair of tights, a thick pullover, white socks and black tennis shoes. Before leaving the house, she also pulled on her new donkey jacket and stuffed a warm scarf into her pocket. Linda lived in Narborough, a village about 6 miles from Leicester city centre. It was what Linda's mother, Kathleen, described as a real English village. Divorcee Kathleen had been a city dweller for most of her life, but had settled there with Linda and her other daughter, Susan, after falling in love with the place. In 1980, she married Eddie Eastwood, a former soldier, and they became a happy family of four. Linda herself was an attractive, dark-haired girl with pale skin. She was outgoing, bubbly, and enthusiastic. She was doing well at school, was studying several languages, and was determined to travel widely as soon as she was able. She seemed to love life. As so often seems to be the case in situations like this, she didn't have an enemy in the world. After school that day, Linda returned home for a quick meal with her stepfather before going back out into the village. She went to visit a friend called Karen Blackwell for a short while before moving on to the home of another friend to collect a record she had lent her. This girl, Caroline, lived in Enderby, a 15-minute walk from Karen Blackwell's, close to a secluded footpath known locally as the Black Pad. It was as Linda made her way back from here that she noticed a figure standing by a lamppost, not far from the gate to the Carlton Hayes Psychiatric Hospital. At 1:30 a.m, Linda had still not returned home. Growing increasingly concerned, her stepfather drove around the village in search of her. He visited various local hangouts, including the Black Pad. When this proved fruitless, he went to Braunston Police Station and reported Linda missing. The police took down her details, but weren't overly concerned, since she hadn't been missing for very long. Eddie Eastwood then went back home to wait. What he didn't know was that when he was searching the Black Pad, he'd been only feet away from making a horrible discovery. The following morning, a hospital porter, on his way to work, decided to take a short cut across the Black Pad. As he did so, he noticed what he thought at first was a partly clothed mannequin lying on the grass near a clump of trees. The body was as white as marble and rigid. As he approached, he realised that it wasn't a dummy at all. It was a young girl. He had discovered the body of Linda Mann. The police were called, and Detective Chief Superintendent David Baker attended. At 8:30 a.m. on the 22nd of November 1983, the murder inquiry had officially begun. The case would go on to become a landmark in the history of forensic science. By a strange coincidence, the technology that was to prove decisive in solving it was developed only a few miles from Narborough, at the University of Leicester, roughly a year after Linda's tragic death. Dr. Alec Jeffries, now Sir Alec, was a graduate of Merton College, Oxford, where he read biochemistry. He remained in Oxford to study for his PhD, and after receiving it, worked for a short spell as a research fellow at the University of Amsterdam, before moving to the University of Leicester in 1977. It was on the 10th of September 1984 that Jeffries made a revolutionary discovery. While examining an X-ray film image of a DNA experiment, he happened to notice that the DNA of different members of his technician's family showed both significant similarities and significant differences. Jeffries quickly realized the importance of this, that individuals could be identified by the unique variations in their genetic code. Every person has their own genetic fingerprint. This means that any genetic material, such as hair, skin cells, or bodily fluids, could now theoretically be matched with the person from whom it came. When Linda's body was discovered, a pathologist was called to the scene. During the course of their examination, they noted matted seminal stains on the vulva hair, something that would later come to be highly significant. After she'd been identified by her stepfather, a post-mortem was carried out. It was established that intercourse had been attempted and that premature ejaculation had occurred. Penetration had also taken place after this and prior to death. Semen was recovered from a deep vaginal swab. The official cause of death was recorded as asphyxia due to strangulation. The semen was subjected to a phosphoglucomutase PGM grouping test. It was also antigen tested and found to have come from a blood group A secretor. Someone from blood group A who secretes antigens from their blood into other bodily fluids such as semen or saliva. The science here is complicated. It's enough for our purposes to know that this meant that the killer was a group A secretor, PGM1+. This was the first breakthrough, as this description would apply to only one male in 10 in the UK. On its own, this information couldn't absolutely identify the killer, but it was useful as it allowed the police to eliminate suspects. Eddie Eastwood's innocence was confirmed in this way, for example. He was never really under suspicion, but in such cases the immediate family always needs to be checked out. However, they seem no closer to catching the culprit. Leads came and went. Suspects were interviewed and allowed to go free. The investigation went on. Linda's body was finally released and she was buried at All Saints Church on the 2nd of February 1984. By April that year, the number of active officers on the case had fallen from 150 to 8. The incident room was closed, and in the summer the inquiry was run down altogether. During the inquiry, 150 blood tests had been carried out, but they had all come to nothing. As time moved on, although the memory of Linda Mann didn't disappear from the consciousness of the village, it did dim a little. The fact that nobody had been held to account kept awareness of the murder alive, but equally the fact that there'd been no further incidents helped the tragic occurrences of November 1983 seem more distant. In July 1986, all that was to change in the most tragic of circumstances. Robin and Barbara Ashworth lived with their two children, Dawn and Andrew, in the village of Enderby, near Narborough. They were a close, loving family. Dawn was 15 years old and had bright, expressive hazel eyes. She was not particularly academic, but possessed a strong artistic streak. To supplement her pocket money, Dawn had a part-time job working in a newsagent. At 3:30 p.m. on the 31st of July 1986, Dawn came home after work. She changed quickly and was about to head back out to see her friends when her mother reminded her that she had to be home by 7 p.m. as they were going to the birthday party of a family friend. As a result of this, Dawn decided to go to buy some sweets as a gift. When she left the house, she was wearing a white polo neck pullover covered by a loose-fitting multicoloured blouse with a white flaring skirt and white canvas pumps. She was also carrying a blue denim jacket. Dawn bought the sweets, and her friends last saw her at approximately 4 p.m. heading towards 10 Pound Lane, a country path that was a short cut between Enderby and Narborough. On her way, she called on several friends, only to discover from their families that they were already out. If only this had not been the case, an awful tragedy might have been averted. I have read of and been involved in many cases where chance has played a significant role in the way that events unfolded. It is a powerful governing force in all our lives and deaths. Dawn began to make her way home along 10 Pound Lane. When she wasn't home by 7 p.m. to attend the party, her parents began to worry. It wasn't like her to be late. She was normally very reliable. Her mother discovered that she had left her friend's house at 4:30 p.m. and hadn't been seen since, which increased their concern. They reported her missing to the police, but were told to wait a little longer. It wasn't unusual for a teenage girl to go missing for a few hours. Dawn's parents knew that in her case, it was. By 9:30 p.m. there was still no sign of her, and her father went out to search for her. He scoured the local streets and the footpaths, and, just like Eddie Eastwood 3 years before, walked past the very spot where his daughter was lying without seeing her. The following day, Friday the 1st of August, the police finally took action, and the Narborough area was alive with search teams and dogs. As is normal in such cases, both Robin and Barbara Ashworth were interviewed at length.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.